Hello, human beings. Music Matters teaching team is back again, and we're here to offer you some more musical content to get you through the quarantine. If you haven't seen any videos yet, I'm Mr. Keenan.
And I'm Mr. Peyton.
And yeah, we're going to teach you some new things today. I'm going to be teaching you some rudiments, and what rudiments are basic drumming sticking techniques to get you more fluid in rhythms and make it more accurate. And then, yeah. So you could use some sticks. If you have some sticks, you can use your hands on your lap. You can hit any surface. I have some toys to play with. You can really hit anything that's not breakable that your parents won't get mad at you for hitting. Lots of different things in your house make cool sounds. Water bottle, anything. I have my keyboard stand here, makes a cool sound. Really, you can just experiment with it, whatever you'd like. Okay, so for now, I'm going to use some sticks. And if you've never used sticks before, or you've forgotten how to hold them, I can show you right now. So we're gonna create a fulcrum, which is the name for the point where you hold the stick, how you hold the stick. So you're going to put your thumbs a little under halfway up the stick, like that, and put your pointer finger under your thumb, like that, okay? And then you just lightly wrap your fingers around. And then with my students, I know it's a little corny, but I like to build a house like that, and then you just bring the house down like that, okay? So you always want your wrists facing down like that, okay? All right, so just gonna do some basic left and right. So I'm gonna start with my left hand. Start with whatever hand you want, as long as you switch later. I'm just gonna go left, right, left, right, left. Those are just called single strokes because you're just using one hand, each hand one time. Okay, so left, right, left, right, left, and then switch, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left. I'm using this drum pad thing to hit on. You can use a bucket if you have a bucket at home, right? So left, right, 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 left, right. Easy enough, right? Okay, so now we're gonna learn a single stroke rudiment. So I have this app. It's called TD Dictionary, and it's a list of different drum rudiments. So I've been kind of picking through them myself. I'm not personally a percussionist, but it's fun to learn new things and to get better at them because it makes you a more well-rounded musician. So on this app, you can hit play, and it shows you how to do the rudiment. So we're going to be playing four stroke rolls. So I'm gonna start with my right hand this time. And it goes like this. Right, left, 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 right, left. We just start with our right hand every time. Right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left. Again. Right, left, 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 right, left. Let's start with your left hand, because you wanna keep it even. So left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right. And then do a little faster. Start with the right hand again. Left hand. Ah. Cool. So you get the idea. And you keep practicing at different tempos. Definitely start really slow at first. Like left, right, left, right. And then you can take various instruments, right? Anything that sounds good in your house that your parents won't get mad that you hit. So I'm gonna take this little bongo thing and this cowbell, and I'm gonna hit them with that pattern. And then opposite. So learning these different rudiments and experimenting with different combinations of hitting things, you can create some cool sounds and cool rhythms. Okay, so that's the single stroke four roll. I'm gonna teach you one more. And we've done this at Music Matters a little bit. It's called a paradiddle. So sticks, hands, whatever. I'm gonna go back to the drum pad just to show you the technique. So what you're gonna do, I'm gonna start with my left hand for this one. You're gonna go left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right. It's good to break it up in half like I did in the first one. So left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right. And then try to get them together. Left, right, left. And then switch which hand you start with. So now we can start with our right hands. Right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left, right, and then do it faster. Right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left. Cool. And then experiment with hitting different combinations of things. So, right? That sounds pretty cool. I'm just doing paradiddles, not even a percussionist. Cool. So, experiment with doing different rhythms like that. Cool. And then I'm going to teach you a little song. I'm going to do it with the bucket and the cowbell here. Or not the bucket, I'm sorry, the bongo and the cowbell. Some of you might have done this at Music Matters on buckets. If you have a bucket, I definitely encourage you to use that. If you have any type of bongo like this, it's totally cool to hit it with a stick. Or your hands, or whatever you're feeling, whatever works for you. Okay. So the lyrics, I've got little lyrics. You've probably heard it before. It's called Jack and Jill. So the rhythm goes like this, and we can do it as an echo. I'll leave some space. So it's Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water. Jack fell down and broke his crown, and Jill came tumbling after. Up Jack got and home did trot as fast as he could caper. Two old Dame Dog who patched his knob with vinegar and brown paper. Okay, so I'll do it a little bit slower. And you can find these lyrics online as well. That's where I found them. So, Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water. Jack fell down and broke his crown, and Jill came tumbling after. Up Jack got and home did trot as fast as he could caper. To old Dame Dob who patched his knob with vinegar and brown paper. Cool. And then there's a drum beat that happens in between each phrase. And it goes like this. It's the same every time. Sorry, messed up. Cool, so I'll do it really slow. So the pattern is actually kind of similar to the paradiddle pattern that we learned earlier. So if you practice the paradiddle pattern, it'll make it a little easier. So, but what I'm doing right now is I'm going right, left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right, left, stick, right, left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right, left, stick. might be easier if you just start by going. And just getting the rhythm down, and then you can start splitting it up. So. Just doing single strokes. Right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right. But you want to do it like this later. So I'll play the whole song now, and then you can rewind the video and just keep practicing the different techniques. So it goes like this. Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water. Jack fell down and broke his crown, and Jill came tumbling after. Up Jack got and home did trot as fast as he could caper. To old Dame Dob, who patched his knob with vinegar and brown paper. Woo. Had a little accent at the end there. My cowbell fell down. Cool. So that's Jack and Jill. Yeah, have fun with it, guys. All right, Mr. Payton, you're up with your portion of teaching.
All righty. Really enjoy those songs, man. I never heard that one before. Like, I know, like, Jack and Jill, like the nursery rhyme, I guess. But
maybe we didn't do it in Music Matters. I thought we did that one, but.
All right. Let me just get this going here. Okay. So we're back for another story time with Mr. Payton. Here we go. Today, we're going to learn about a really, really cool musician I came across probably when I was only a little bit older than you guys. I believe I was checking out one of the people we've already talked about, Dizzy Gillespie, and he was playing with him in a concert that they did together. This guy's name is Paquito de Rivera. He is one of the most incredible clarinetists and saxophonists I've ever heard in my life. He is also, like the theme of the week, an Afro-Cuban jazz musician. He's probably one of the few that I know that came straight from Cuba, other than like another one, Arturo Sandoval, who's really, really big trumpet player that like we all really admire. If you're a trumpet player, you really can't get around that guy, but I might get to him another week. I might have like a trumpet nerd week, who knows? But but today we're gonna learn about Paquito de Rivera. He was born in Havana, Cuba in 1948. He's actually the only guy that we've talked about this week that's still alive. His father was a classical saxophonist, actually, and he made sure that little Paquito got experience to all the greats. I mean, he grew up on Duke, Benny Goodman. He took him to this club in Cuba that's really famous called Tropicana. It's kind of like the, like the Blue Note or like or a Village Vanguard kind of thing of Cuba. Those are both very famous jazz clubs in America. He was taught saxophone by his father, obviously, until he was old enough to go to the Havana Conservatory of Music and learn clarinet and saxophone. Now, for those of you who don't know what a conservatory is, it's kind of like a college that only focuses on one specific thing. Like, for instance, in this instance, it's music. But there are also conservatories of dance. There are other art conservatories. It's primarily an art-based concept, but essentially, it's just a school where you only focus on that. So you wouldn't have to take math or like science as like a kind of like general requirement. Like you audition for the school and it's primarily just music and maybe a couple life skills like humanities, like reading and writing skills, like things that will also help you become an academic of the music. Later on in his career, after he kind of like started becoming prominent in Cuba, he eventually decided to defect from the country, like many Cuban musicians did, because of all the political constraints at the time. And for our kids, that basically means their president was telling him what he could play, when he could play it, and how he was supposed to play it. Which, I mean, you guys don't like to listen to us half the time. So, you know, you can imagine being an adult and being told what to do in that way. Especially when you're a music lover and performer who thrives on being creative and being able to do whatever you want to do. So by 1980, he was just like, you know, this isn't for me. I gotta get out of here. So while he was on tour in Spain, he got kind of asylum in an American embassy, and they kind of found a way to get him out of Cuba without their government knowing. So eventually he brought his family over later, but that was kind of how he started becoming prominent in America. He just decided, oh, I'm out. Now, why is he important? I kind of got into a little bit of that already, but he's one of the most prominent Cuban-born jazz musicians. Like I said, like, from that area, there was kind of a little bit of influence from America, like through like, you know, like records being sent over there and whatnot, but only a couple of those guys really took to the jazz form, because it honestly is very similar to their Cuban music, which is why Afro-Cuban music works so well. He's also one of the first Cuban musicians to play on some of the most hallowed stages in America. I mean, I think I get into it in a couple of his accolades, but I mean, he's played in like Carnegie Hall, Symphony Hall in Chicago. I mean, he's one of the first guys who was really big on playing jazz in front of orchestras as well. They kind of get into it with like some other guys did, maybe like Birds with Strings, Clifford with Strings, but those are more studio projects. Meaning they like got into a booth and recorded it like just kind of separate from live performances. But he was really, really big. A lot of his accolades include playing out in front of orchestras. All right. So let's check out what this guy is made of. This is called Samba for Carmen. And it's probably one of the first times I've ever heard the clarinet played and was like, holy crap. I mean, the guy was just, I'm very excited to show you guys this. And the pianist, it's a duo, meaning there's just, or duo or duet, which means just two people performing. And it's with pianist Danilo Perez. I'm sure Mr. Keenan is hip to him.
And I would like to introduce
everybody know who that is.
A man who has become a grandmaster in this Native American art form. Only he is.
The island of Cuba. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my great pleasure now to introduce Mr. Paquito de Rivera.
Thank you.
it.
Woo-wee.
It gets pretty toasty in the back half, but I'll make sure to include the link whenever we post this. Because, man, yeah, it gets pretty buck wild, not going to lie.
That was awesome, Peyton. Thank you.
Oof. All right. Just a couple of his awards and accolades. I'll just read these down for you guys. 2003, his doctorate honoris causa in music from Berklee College of Music. Clarinet of the Year Award, Jazz Journalist Association, NEA Jazz Masters, very, very important. National Medal of the Arts, super important. Once again, Clarinet of the Year. Fellowship Award for Music Composition at Guggenheim Foundation. That's a very, very, very hard thing to accomplish. The Guggenheim Foundation basically gives someone X amount of time and resources to just go write. You know, compose whatever you need to, or for just an extended period of time. Also got the Living Jazz Legend Award from the Kennedy Center. Really, really, really important. I mean, there are so many jazz musicians who are still alive, and to be considered a legend while you're still breathing is pretty incredible. And now that he teaches and is an older age, he's also got the International Association for Jazz Educators President's Award. But yeah, that's basically Paquito de Rivera in a nutshell. Feel free, like we always say, to dig even deeper, check out some more of his music. I mean, incredible musician. And that's basically all I got on him.
That was sweet. That video was a treat, Peyton. I'm personally going to dig more deeply into him now.
You gotta watch the back half of it. It's just like incredible. Like he starts playing saxophone and like it's like a totally new groove.
And Daniil Perret, dude, that dude is so. He's still alive too.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I came across that video when I was way too young to really, like, I don't know, hear all the, like, stuff up here, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And, like, I think I started looking at that stuff when I was in middle school, like, right when I first started getting, like, into music. Like, I was probably, like, 12, 13.
I remember Paquito being, like, really pushed hard in high schools, and then I just kind of, like, I didn't forget about him, but I just got into other things, but, man.
Right.
Definitely a living legend, for sure.
Well, so we don't have Mr. Jake with us today, so we're going to kind of transition into a what are we listening to now phase of this. Stop sharing my screen.
Should I go first?
Yeah, I just talked a lot, so you're...
So, I don't know about you, Mr. Peyton. I'm sure you do, but I listen to a lot of music. I listen to at least a few albums a day. I know with streaming and stuff and YouTube, it's really easy to listen to just like single songs. Like this is one song I like, this is another song I like, this single, that single, and that's perfectly fine. Like I personally, I release singles. So like I know it's really easy to get kind of like caught up in that stream of things, but listening to whole albums is so important too. And one album that in particular that I've been listening to is by an artist called Prince. That's just his name is Prince. And you've probably heard some songs by him that you know. There's Kiss and Purple Rain. There's all sorts of more pop Prince that is really mainstream. An album in particular that I've been checking out is called The Rainbow Children. And it was released, I believe, in 2000 or 2001. 2002, and that's when a lot of neo soul music was coming out. So artists like Erykah Badu, D'Angelo, Common, Bilal, RH Factor, all these guys and women were making some really beautiful soul music, and it was called neo soul because it's an evolution of soul and R&B. So, but this Prince record kind of deviates from his pop rock sound and is more neo-soul jazz-based, and it's really beautiful, and I'm going to share the second track off it. It's called Muse to the Pharaoh. So I'll just play a good amount of it, and then I'll talk about why I like it.
bring presents and wine. The helix he might get between them. In other words, intertwine with the ebony and milk of her thighs. If she could be amused, let him decide. Perhaps she let him decide. She could be amused. That long. There is nothing, nothing he wouldn't give her. See, no. For the future of the nation rests in her belly. And if the proverb of the 31 and verse 10 becomes a song she sings again and again, she might be queen. She could be news to the pharaoh. Wonder she might be. Take a load off.
Yeah, there's so many reasons why I love this album. So one really fascinating thing about, well, there's a plethora of fascinating things about Prince, but one really fascinating thing about him is on a lot of his records, he played all of the instruments. I don't know for a fact if he did on this one, but it's very possible he did. Some other artists who did that, Stevie Wonder, yeah, tons of people. So it's another reason to be encouraged to be a well-rounded musician is you could be like these guys who just do everything. He also, like, I believe Prince choreographed all of his live stuff, like movements too. Peyton, I don't know if you've ever watched any live videos of him, but it's a treat. It's really a treat, especially from that era and earlier. His live videos, tons of live videos of him on YouTube. Yeah.
I've only ever seen him really play like award shows, honestly. But yeah, I'm like just listening to his audio tracks. I haven't really dug deep in his live stuff, but I mean, from what I've seen from like just like the few award shows that he's done, I mean, like, dude can play. Like,
he can play, yeah, definitely. And dance too. Very like Michael Jackson-esque in the right. Live. Dance movements and choreographed stuff. Yeah, I love so much about that song. The vocal harmonies are so rich and like churchy and soulful. The little improvised solo he took. Improvised means you make it up on the spot and create your own rhythms and notes. Obviously, Mr. Payton, you know that's for the kids.
Yeah. I was backing you up visually with my face.
Yeah, I really encourage you guys to listen to that whole album and any songs you listen to. I have no idea what you guys are listening to, but if you find a song you like, try to find the album that it's on, if it is part of an album, and just listen to the whole thing, even if you hate it. It just gives you a vision of like what that artist was thinking about and what they wanted to express. It's like reading a whole book instead of like just a chapter of it. So.
Yeah, I mean, really, really awesome. I've always been sort of like a, how should I say, casual Prince fan. I never really got into him like super deep, but he was just like a part of like the lexicon, I guess, of what I was just listening to as a young person, you know, just because my mom is very beautiful still, but she's on the older side. So I definitely listen to a lot of old school music, and Prince was definitely a part of that. I don't know, like, I kind of want to call an audible and just like listen to the rest of that, like Paquita Du Rivera video, honestly, just because it's like a totally different tune, like right at that moment. So,
oh yeah, let's do it. Let's hear it.
share my screen.
Danilo Ferris.
Is Arturo in there?
Yeah. No, this is
Caray was sitting. Who was the other trombone player that took the solo? Do you know?
Slide Hampton.
That was Slide? Dude.
Yeah. Lord. Yeah, man. This is like a part of this concert that Dizzy put together. It was his United Nations Jazz Orchestra. And yeah, they did like a whole tour thing, but they had like one concert where they recorded like the whole thing. And like, I mean, that concert is like an hour long thing.
The whole thing, the part,
video was like in like 8 parts on YouTube. And like, I probably watched this concert probably like more times than I could ever really count at the time. Like, I don't know, that didn't make sense, but I watched it a lot.
I'm going to watch that today.
Yeah, just like if you could find it, it's to the United Nations Jazz Orchestra, man. Like that whole concert is like banging, like the whole thing.
Who's on trumpet?
That was Claudio Roditi.
Word. Okay.
Yeah, dude's like disgusting. I mean, like this dude, like it was just like the energy in his line, like
yeah, yeah. It's some sweet stuff, man. Thank you for sharing that.
Of course. I think that's a great end to our Afro-Cuban week.
Mm. Yeah, definitely. Especially with Coldplay, that's the best Afro-Cuban of them all.
Yeah. We all count Jake as a part of the Afro-Cuban. He's just our daily dose of choir.
Yeah. Cool. Do you have any thoughts about that video and like why you like it?
I think I particularly like it because of the energy that everyone brings to the performance. Like, you can tell no one's just sort of, like, phoning it in, you know?
Yeah.
Like, everybody's really digging in and kind of trying to contribute to the collective good.
Mm. I like how Dizzy just brings the vibe. Like, he didn't even play in that song, I don't think.
Nope.
He just brings the vibe, dude. That's so serious.
Well.
Yeah. Those are the same reasons I like it.
Yeah, all right. Next week, please stay tuned for next week's theme from at least from my end. I'm going to try to keep every week sort of like, hey, this week we're going to be talking about this kind of thing. And try to keep it as consistent as possible. Actually, I believe next week is spring break.
Yeah. If you guys have anything that you want to learn, maybe message Miss Kalita or Miss Susan or anything like that, or I don't know if you can leave comments in the YouTube videos, but reach out to us somehow in whatever way you can if there's anything that you guys want to check out and learn or expand on.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you just have any questions about what we did teach already.
Yeah, we're more than welcome to just go in the comments and answer all your questions, or you can email us. All of our emails should be available.
Yeah. All right. I guess that's it. As always, keep staying curious and staying engaged and keep learning in this really weird time that we're all in. So that's what I'm doing. I'm spending a lot of time by myself in my room figuring things out. So I'm sure Mr. Payton is as well.
Yep, absolutely. I'm very much so as in school as you guys are. So I am also working and going to school from home. So.
Yeah. All right. Love you guys. Have a good spring break, and we'll be back in a couple weeks with some more content. Peace.